Because if we want a true blessing, the way to receive it is to pray for someone else.
Yes.
The quickest way to get a blessing is to be a blessing to somebody else. When you find yourself in need, the thing to do is to find somebody that's in worse need than you.
Amen.
And to be a blessing to them. Always remember, my brothers and sisters, doing good always brings a blessing. Showing somebody else love will in turn bring love back to you. We are so concerned, I found out, about ourselves that we're going, about ourselves and what we're going through until we don't think about nobody else. You hear folks say, child, I'm trying to do all I can to make it. My five and no job. My four and no more. Ain't got time for nobody else. I'm trying to do all I can to pay my bills. But if you want to be a blessing, it's a blessing to be a blessing to somebody else. If you want God to do it for you, you ought to do it for somebody else. I was doing certain things for people, amen, will it determine, amen, a blessing for us. We find ourselves praying always for ourselves, but we need, again, to just put somebody else first. Let you be last and put somebody else first. Jesus even said it. Jesus said the first shall be last and the last shall be first, didn't he, y'all? Amen. And sometimes we ought to put others before us before we put our needs before others. I'm reminded in the book of James chapter 5 and 16 where James says, confess your faults one to another and pray for one another that you may be healed. Are y'all going to pray with me here? Yes, there's so many people out there in the world today that need prayer. They need a blessing. They need a miracle. They need a touch from God. They need a word of encouragement. They need to know that everything is going to be all right. But sometimes we're so consumed with our problems until we ain't got time for nobody else. But if you would just lay your problems inside, say, I'm going to go out in the world and I'm going to find somebody I can help. And how many know there's enough people in the world you ain't got to search too far? Somebody that you can feed, somebody that you can clothe, somebody that you can help pay a bill, somebody that you can mop the floor, somebody that you can give some clothing to that ain't doing you no good no more. There's always somebody that you can be a blessing to. Come on, say amen. Come on, say hallelujah. Come on, say glory to God. This, my brothers and sisters, is what we need to do. Pray for somebody else. This was the key to Job's deliverance. As we look at Job here, amen, had he not prayed for his friends, amen, he would have never came out of his dilemma. Amen, even these same friends accused Job of sin, he still had to look beyond that and pray for them. We have to pray for our enemies. Y'all didn't know that, did you? Yeah, Matthew 5 and 44 said, but I say unto you, love your enemies. Bless them that curse you and do good unto them that hate you and pray for them that despitefully use you and that persecute you. You got to pray for your enemies. Wait a minute, Pastor Mitchell, what you talking about? This man trying to destroy my reputation. He trying to get me fired. He's trying to tear my marriage. He trying to do everything he can because he don't like me. You mean I got to turn around and pray for him? Yes! Bible said when Jesus was on the cross, the man was dying. He was in the imminent, amen, death. He was getting ready to die, but he stopped dying long enough to say, Lord, forgive them, for they know not what they do to me. And if Jesus can do that on the cross, what about you and I? If Jesus can look beyond what they're doing to him and look at their soul and say, Lord, forgive them, what about you and your enemies? Come on, say amen. You don't do to your enemies what your enemies do to you. Because two wrongs don't make it right. Come on, say amen. Well, they got at me, I'm going to get back to them. They killed my little cousin, I'm going to kill their little cousin. Amen. Then where does the killing end? Everybody killing everybody. I was looking on the news the other day where they're getting ready to prosecute the young man that went to that funeral at Bonaventure 2 years ago and killed that little 12-year-old boy at the funeral home. Now he's being prosecuted as a grown man. Amen. Because he was paying the family back that killed his family member. He went there to the funeral home and killed their family member. Y'all ain't talking to me here. In other words, it's a no-win situation. Nobody wins in that situation because you got two dead people and two hurting families. But you are supposed to love and pray for your what? Your enemies. That's what Matthew 5 and 44 say. But here in the text, amen, Job here is a perfect example of a person going through. I mean, Job was going through. Somebody say going through. Job was going through. Every time Job looked around, he was going through something or another. Job found himself, amen, all of a sudden going through and going from prosperity to poverty. He found himself from going from fame to shame. He found himself from going from lending to borrowing. Amen. As far as we know, Job was not reaping anything he sowed because of his condition. For the Bible said that Job was an upright man. And Job, come on somebody, he was a pious man. He was a religious man. So, amen, a lot of times people will look at you when you're going through something, and the first thing they say, you reaping what you sow. But I found out in this walk with God, you ain't got to necessarily do nothing wrong for wrong to come back to you. You can be minding your own business and loving people and doing right, and all of a sudden the whole bottom drop out. Yeah, but everything going right goes wrong. But you didn't seek out nobody and hurt nobody. You were minding your own business. But how many know that's just the ways of life? Amen. How many know life will deal you a bad hand? Life will take you through. Life will knock the breath out of you. Come on, have you ever been going your way, minding your business, and all of a sudden everything just happened to you? You looked over here, that happened, and that happened. Amen. You looked around, and then that happened to you. And this was the situation, my brothers and sisters, with Job. He was minding his own business. The Bible said he was an upright man. He was a righteous man. He was a man of integrity. He was a man going around doing the will of God. Amen. Job went to church. Job paid his tithes. Job served God. Amen. Job did everything that a man could do in the eyes of God. He was well respected in the land of Oz. Everybody knew that Job was a religious person. And he never hurt a fly. He never did nothing to nobody. He walked upright before God. But I'll tell you what happened. What happened was not so much that Job did anything that was wrong, but what happened was that once upon a time, there was a meeting up in heaven. The Bible said that there was a day in the first chapter of Job, that there was a day when the sons of men presented themselves before the Lord. And the sons of men are better known as the angels. The angels on a daily basis came before God and before the throne. And the Bible said not only did the angels come before God, but Satan came also. Now, those of you that know your Bible, you remember Satan. Amen. He was kicked out of heaven. Is that right? He was kicked out of heaven because of the 14th chapter of Isaiah. He tried to put himself above God. The devil said, I will be as the Most High. Satan said, I will make my kingdom in the north. And we know that the north is the direction of God. Satan did not say, I will be like God. He said, I will be above. Y'all ain't talking to me. How do you know anything with two heads is a monster? And Satan said, I'm going to take the place of God. And right then and there, he was cast out of heaven. But let me tell you this. He was cast out of heaven, but he still had access to heaven. Come on, somebody. Explain that, Pastor Mitchell. He had access to heaven because the Bible said there was a day when the sons of God presented themselves before the Lord and Satan came also. So that lets me know he still had, y'all ain't talking to him, he still had access to heaven. Amen. He was up there. He ain't had no business up there, but he still had keys. Come on, y'all ain't talking to me. You put that man out, you better get your keys. Because he can come back in there. Come to me here. So he still, Mother said, he still had access to heaven. And that booger was trying to hide behind some of the angels. And the Lord saw through him. And the Lord said, Satan, what are you doing up here? He said, I'm going to and fro, up and down the earth, seeking whom I may devour. In other words, the devil was saying, God, I'm looking for somebody I can raise hell in. I'm looking for somebody that I can bring trouble through. I'm looking for somebody that'll bring looking for somebody that'll raise hell in the church. How many of you know the devil is powerless without a body? Oh, come on, y'all help me preach. He got to get into something. He got to get into somebody. If he can't get into something or somebody, he ain't got no power. That's it. Come, you ought to tell your neighbor, don't bring the devil to church. Oh, come on, y'all clap that up. Don't bring the devil to church. Don't let the devil ride. You let him ride, he don't want to try. Don't let him be your friend because you're losing the end. Don't let that devil come to church with you. I'm a witness. He'll try to come to church. He'll try to get in that car. Yes, he will too. He'll try to ride with you. Then you know when he comes here, he want to show out. Come on here. So before he show out, I'm going to pull him out. The Bible said that the devil said, Lord, I'm going what? To and fro, up and down, seeking whom I may devour. Y'all giving your attention here. But you know what? The Lord said, devil, I got just a man for you. God said, I got somebody that'll fit you real good. If I can fathom in my mind, my God. And I know the Bible don't say it, but if I can fathom in my mind, sister preacher, the Lord said, let me go to the fire cabinet. He looked up under the letter J. Y'all ain't talking to me. And I ain't talking about Jesus, but I'm talking about a man called Job. And the Bible said, amen, that God looked in that cabinet and went through the cabinet and went through the files and pulled out Job. Talk to me here. And the devil told Satan, he said, listen, I got just a man for you. His name is Job. Now let me tell you something. The Bible said that God recommended the devil to Job. Come on here, y'all. It wasn't Job that recommended himself to the devil, but it was God that recommended the devil to Job. Now that right there lets me know that God must have thought something of Job to recommend him to the devil. In other words, God knew what was in Job. God knew that Job wasn't going to break under pressure. God knew that Job wasn't going to curse him and die. God knew that Job wasn't going to backslide. God knew that Job wasn't going to throw in the tower. God knew that Job wasn't going to give up. God knew that Job didn't care what they said about him. God knew that Job knew that sticks and stones may break his bones, but won't no words harm him. God knew what was in Job. In order for God to recommend Job to the devil, he had to know what was in him. And God knew that Job was a man that the devil couldn't break. God knew that Job was a man that the devil couldn't shake. And no matter what the devil did to Job, God knew he wasn't going to break. I wonder, is there anybody in this morning that God can recommend you to the devil and know that you ain't going to break, and know that you ain't going to give up, and know that you ain't going to give out? Look at somebody and say, he knew what was in Job better than Job knew what was in himself. And the Lord made a pact with the devil. The Lord said, do what you want to him. You can take him from fame to shame. You can take him from prosperity to poverty. You can do whatever you want. You can even afflict his body. But one thing you better not do, you better not let him die. Y'all ain't talking to me. You can put your hand on him. You can suffocate him, but he better breathe. You can stab him, but he better not bleed out. Talk to me, somebody. You can do whatever you want to do to him, but you better not die. Why somebody want to know why the Lord said he better not die? Because the Lord knew that Job's life was in his hand. Tell somebody, your life is in God's hand. It don't matter what the devil do to you, you can't die. Talk to me here. He'll let you live with cancer in the last stage and still don't die. Yes, he will. Yes, he will. Hallelujah. I've been telling y'all a long time that we're living with diseases that folk have died with. Nothing but the grace of God. Shout yeah. Yeah. See him. He said unto the devil, you better not kill him. And one by one, y'all know the story of Job. He began to lose everything. He had 7 sons and 3 daughters. All of them died in the house. He lost his money. He lost his honey. His wife looked at him and said, Job, why don't you curse God and die? He said, you talk like a foolish woman. You ain't my wife. You're an imposter. You're the real Miss Job. Please stand up. Talk to me. He had lost it all. Lost his children. Lost his honey. Lost his money. Lost his wife. He lost everything. Is there anybody in here that ever lost everything? Come to me. Have you ever been on the mountain? And one day you hit the valley. Come to me. I have. Jesus said, I'll be with you. Unto the end of the world. Say it. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, if you want a blessing, come on, say, if you want a blessing, pray for me. Come on, say, pray for me. One by one, Job had four friends, and the Bible said these four friends came to Job. You know what their job was? Their job was to comfort him. Their job was to comfort him during his time of trouble. But one by one, the Bible said when they got to Job's house for 7 days, they didn't say a word. 7 days, you're supposed to be my prayer partner, and I'm going through hell, and you come over my house and sit there and look at me and don't say a word for 7 days. What kind of help are you? And then when they did open their mouth, they accused Job of doing wrong. Hold up, wait a minute. You're supposed to be my friend, and instead of encouraging me, you accusing me of the wrong that I've done. When they got through with Job, you know what Job said? They were miserable comforters. And that's what Job said, I could do that by myself. Y'all could have kept that. Y'all could have stayed home. That wasn't even worth the drive. Talk to me, somebody. I don't know, when you're going through, you don't need nobody to condemn you. When you're going through, you don't need nobody to pull you down. But I need somebody that's going to pick me up. Say yeah. Come on and say yeah. And they begin to accuse old man Job. They said, surely Job, you've done wrong. Surely Job, you're reaping what you sow. See that, Job, what you did when you was young is coming back to bite you. See that, Job, them lies you told are coming back on you. See that, Job, that woman you stole is coming back on you. See that, Job, them trips to the motel, them trips to the hotel is coming back on you. See that, Job, that drugs you took are coming back on you. But the Bible said Job didn't say a word. He said the Lord get it and the Lord take it away. He said bless it. Be the name of the Lord. But after they had left, I said after they had left the house and the smoke had cleared and it got quiet, the Spirit of the Lord, my preacher, y'all help me, the Spirit of the Lord, come back to me, the Spirit of the Lord begin to deal with Job and say, Job, if you really want to come out, if you really want to be delivered, if you really want to come out, pray for your friends, the one that just accused you. Go back and pray for them. Come on, somebody. Tell your neighbor if you want a blessing. Pray for your friends. Am I right about it? And the Bible said, look at what the scripture said. After Job prayed for his friends, God turned it around for Job and gave him double for his trouble. Shake your neighbor by the hand and say, neighbor, if you want a blessing, pray for your friends. Clap those hands and open your mouth. Somebody make some noise. I need to hear somebody out there. I need to hear some hands clap out there. I need to hear somebody open their mouth. I need to hear somebody. Yeah, what you did to me hurt me, but I'm going to pray for you. What you did to me embarrassed me, but I'm going to pray for you. What you did to me made it look like I wasn't doing my job, but I'm going to pray for you. What you did to me gave me a bad name in the community, but I'm going to pray for you. What you did to me messed up my reputation, but I'm going to pray for you. Hallelujah. Because if I pray for you, he'll release me. Shake somebody by the hand and say, if I pray for you, he'll release me. Put them hands together. Open your mouth. Come on, open your mouth. Come on, praise us. Come on, praise us. I need some praises in here. Come on, clap those hands. I know y'all tired. Hallelujah. Who got what I was preaching? Who got what I was saying today? And God turned. When he prayed for his friend. Job couldn't have come out until he prayed for them. You got that, Evangelist Johnson? And when he prayed for them, God turned the captivity of Job. That means Job getting out was predicated on him praying for them. Who understand what I'm saying? God turned, and not only God turned the captivity of Job, but God gave him twice as much as he had before. God will give you double for your trouble if you pray for your friend. You want a blessing? Pray for me. That's a sermon today. You want a blessing? Pray for me. You want a double blessing? Pray for your enemies. You want a double blessing? Pray for that one that's trying to get you fired. Pray for the one that can't stand your guts. Pray for the one that don't look you in your face and told you they don't like you. Pray for them. Pray for the one that's plotting to get you off your job. Plotting to get you fired. Pray for them. And God turned the captivity of Job when he prayed for his friend. Why did God do it for Job? Because the Bible said, remember I told you to underline that part? And God accepted Job. Y'all ain't got that. You know what that means? God accepted Job. That means everything Job did in the eyes of God was clean. Was right. And God honored Job. Now don't you not know if God honored Job and Job prayed for his friend, God would honor the prayer? Who got that? Who just got that? God will honor the prayer because God honored too. So God honored whatever came out of his mouth. The friends were supposed to be a blessing to Job, but they wasn't a blessing to him. Because what did they do? They accused him. But then he had to turn around and bless the ones that was cursing him. Now, how does that work? Tell somebody what's wrong with that picture. Here you're supposed to be blessing me. And until you blessing me, you cursing me. Then the Lord gonna tell me, because he honored me, because he accept me, he gonna tell me to find you that just cursed me to pray for you. And when I pray for you, the bondage I was in, I'm out. Woo, y'all just sitting there looking at me. They gonna get it tomorrow. Somebody gonna get it after a while. Don't you know you praying for them is doing you a favor? You praying for them is bringing you out. So if you don't pray for them, you gonna stand. Look what the verse said. Look what the verse said. And God turned the captivity of Job when he prayed for his friend. Job was at the bottom. He had lost it all, didn't he, y'all? And on top of that, he was sick. But when he prayed for them boys,
yes,
God turned it around and said, now, Job, through your obedience of praying for them, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to bring you out because you prayed for them. Y'all get this?
Yes.
When I'm praying for y'all and I'm preaching to y'all, don't y'all know I'm delivering myself?
Yes.
I'm setting me up for a blessing. That's a couple, you ought to run and find somebody to pray for. You got to get up right now. Get up right now. Get up right now. Get up. Come on, y'all, get up right now. Then go to somebody right now. Go to somebody right now. Just start praying for them. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Go to somebody, 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 somebody. Go to somebody and start praying. If you don't say but two words, if you don't say but three words, pray on them right now.
Right now, Lord Jesus, I'm praying right now, Lord. I just want
Hallelujah,
Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah.
My God, glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Hallelujah. Now clap your hands and give him a praise, Father.
Thank you.
Woo! See, won't this week God turn your captivity? Tell somebody this week. God is going to turn my captivity in the name of Jesus. This week, God is going to turn my situation because I prayed for you.